I mean, I ate them. You know, I had a Sierra Mist.
No, we don't have any.
No, she didn't even bother telling me nothing. She just extended the pretzels again. And I had to make a choice. Either I'm going to take them or I'm not. So, you know, I had a lot of respect for her. She was cool.
Chico? The girl from Japan?
No, I haven't.
Okay, talk to her. She wasn't a, they made it seem like she couldn't get into the country because she had no visa.
I needed a visa! And I didn't know that! Do I have to know my visa?
All Americans, because of the agreement that they have with Belize, can come in without a visa. Like, you don't have to pay, you don't have to be pre-approved or anything. But Japan and Belize don't have the same kind of relationship. So she just had to fill out all the paperwork, pay $50. They're like, we can't come in without a visa. So that was a little scary.
It was a great ride. Good company all around. I was kind of left behind because I was late to come on the flight. I had to eat a few rows back from the place, but I wasn't that lonely because I had pretty good company now. I enjoyed the movie, but I was kind of disappointed in, you know, the overall outcome of what the story was really trying to portray. And in the end, I cried because my mother wasn't there for the second Christmas.
Then you can tell me. And once I forgot everybody's name, we'll do a roll call.
Okay.
Because I've only met like a quarter of you guys. Hey, what's up, Esther?
Troy.
Quarter and a half. Right, what's up, Troy? Nice to meet you. And even though I've met that quarter of you, I still don't remember your names. So you're like, me.
Adrian.
What's up, we have an easy one.
Thank you.
Oh, wait, we have
you have a dog at home? Do you have a dog? Does it look like this dog?
Why?
Why?
Because if you went to the king without his permission, walked in there, and he did not extend his scepter, you would be killed. Mm. So I told Mordecai to fast and to pray for me, and I prayed to God for 3 days. I went into the king's palace, opened the king's door, not knowing what would happen to me. But God had placed me here for this specific reason. I walked closer and closer and closer to the king's throne. He put his hand on his scepter and extended it to me. My life was saved. The king said, "My beautiful wife, what do you want? I will give you anything, up to half the riches in my kingdom." I said, "Oh, king, my people are going to be killed." He said, "What? Your people?" "Yes, king, I am a Jew, and Haman is trying to kill all of us." The king had no idea what he hadn't realized what he had done. He immediately said the law was not going to happen and all my people were saved. I had no idea that when God told me to go to the beauty contest, I would one day end up saving my entire people. God places you in a place like this for his purpose. We have to be strong and we have to do what God tells us. God has a purpose for every person.
You want the day? I'm going to go back to it.
Let's see. Come on, let's see the muscle. Where's it at? Where's it at? Come on, let's see.
Wave and smile. Say hi. You're good, bro.
You got it.
Whoa, that root is a lot more stable than I thought it would be.
You got it, bro? Don't you worry about it. I got you. I think I'm okay. I don't know. You look a little pale.
I'm a little shaky. I don't know.
Thank you.
Jody. Jody, hold on. If I lose you, I lose the worship leader.
Don't you go dying on me.
Tyler, I'm sorry.
Oh. Thank you. Sorry.
You all right?
What in the name of me
is going on here?
No, don't be like
that.
Climb it.
before, so it had some preparation time. But as you can see, the water is flowing, and it is live. Now, this hole here is called the Pit of Death. Star Wars currently took it for its movie, and Jabba the Hutt is right above it, with arrows pointing down, telling you that you will die if you go in. Ladies and gentlemen, if you ever come here, please recognize the big, deep hole with water. Do not go in it. I repeat, do not go in it. You will die.
Thank you. Boom, 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 put your legs in.
Come on! Come on! Come on!
Come on, boom!
Amazing grace, Jesus is near as he took my place.
how the ladies carry their baby. And if the baby starts to cry, you go like this. It's okay, baby. It's okay. And then you pat its head like this.
And after that, you go to the masseuse.
And it hurts your neck really bad. Is it? These women are very strong. My neck is cramping. And then this is how you walk. So you can do it with no hands.
This is Mike and this is Sam. They're with Trick Force Expedition. They're not Katie and Jen. But they're with, it's an organization from England that they're doing some charitable work for. We met them here. They're teaching English at the school here.
Maria.
In
Sunday
Wood.
I don't need any more practice.
Awesome school.
Yeah. Sam here has won a contest for the Hugh Grant look-alike. He's very proud of that. He heads the fan club for George Bush in Belize. He's part of that fan club for everything.
Sam and Frodo.
He started the club. He started it.
That's right. He started the fan club.
God, I thank you that you have placed each one of these children here on this earth, and you know them, and you know their potential. And right now, we just bless them in Jesus' name. And I pray, Lord God, that your hand would be on them all the days of their life, Lord, and that they would know you, and they would know their potential, and that you would help them to grow, help them to do well in school, help them to become influential in this country, and help them to make a difference with their life, in Jesus' name. Now we bless you, Lord. We bless these children.
Take a walk.
Come on, bro.
Careful with that rock. I'm trying to recuperate from my... I had a really sad day today. Kind of recovered a little bit.
What happened, bro? What happened?
All my homies... They kind of... went their separate ways, you know?
Yeah.
They totally went to another village and left me back at the other village. But anyway, it was alright, you know. I was doing the slingshot thing and I was picturing to see if I can maybe pull Bart far enough and hit Adrian in the back of the head with a water balloon just to get my anger and my rage out from him. He said he got my back and, you know, he wanted to hang out. Steven, Joel's. I don't know why they left me behind. We wanted to experience this thing together. That's what we said at the start. We said that from the start. Bro, we're going to go to your hometown. We're going to kick it. I want you to show me stuff. We're talking about the Gibnot the whole time back home. The whole time. And then they go off to a hut and there's a Gibnot right there. And then they play with the Gibnot. And then they came back and showed me in a piece of, you know, camera. Like that one. The little tiny screen. Look, bro, we got a Gibnot, bro. And I wasn't there to experience their first Gibnot experience.
See on Fair Factor, bro.
You bite it, goes.
Ooh, man.
Look at this back.
Yeah, did the points on it?
God, I wish I could try to keep that one around and get to see him. Put your camera down there so I see how big this thing is. It's a pretty day.
So what's for lunch today, Trey?
Hot dogs. Big buns. Their buns are huge down here. It's like you have half a hot dog.
Faces, and I expect for this team to turn those frowns upside down. That says a lot right there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you think maybe she got lost? It's kind of hard to get to Bronco, huh? Let me see if I can find it. Queen Esther! Queen Esther! Oh my goodness.
There she is. I see her coming.
Oh, I made it! Hello! How are you today? Okay. I must walk straight and proud. You see, I am a queen, so I must practice how to be dignified and to be walk with grace. I would much rather be playing outside right now, but I never knew that one day I would become queen, so I need to train. A long time ago, maybe 10 or 20 years ago, there was a beauty contest to see who was the most beautiful woman in all the land. I had a cousin, and he came to me, and he said, Esther, you must go. You are the most beautiful lady in all the land. I did not think so, and I was very shy, and I did not want to. I was also afraid. But my cousin was very wise, so I listened to his words. So, I adjourned to the palace. I went to the palace, and I spent one whole year doing body treatments, making my skin very soft. I spent a whole year there preparing myself to go before the king. Because when you go before the king, you must be presentable. So I trained and washed and scrubbed. Finally, one year was done. It was my turn to enter into the king's throne room. So I walked tall and straight. I got closer and closer, closer to the king. I looked into his eyes, and he smiled at me. Then he nodded to his servant. I was chosen to be queen. I could not believe it. Out of all of the people here, I was chosen to be queen. The king found favor with me. At this time, I had no idea why. Why would I be chosen to be queen? But God had a plan for my life. In the land at that time, there was an evil man. His name was Haman. And he came and he wanted to destroy all of the Jews. And I too am a Jew. He wanted to kill all of the Jews in the land. And he got the king to agree with him. But the king did not know that I was a Jew. My cousin came to me and he said, Esther, Esther, you must tell the king to save our people. I cannot do it. My heart started racing, beating very quickly when he told me this. I said, no, cousin, I cannot do this. If I enter the king's palace uninvited, I could be killed. Esther, he said, who knows? Maybe you were chosen for such a time as this. So I sat and I waited and I prayed to God. Finally, I decided to trade in my beauty for bravery. I was going to be brave and stand up for my people, even though I may have died. So the time came. I came closer to the king's throne. I stepped in, and I was not invited. But I came closer, and I came closer, feeling more and more afraid. Finally, I got close to the king, and all of a sudden, he held out his scepter. Oh, can you imagine? I felt so much better. That meant that I would be saved and that I could speak to the king. He spared my life. I then told the king, oh, king, Haman, the evil man, he wants to kill all of my people. I am a Jew, and he wants to kill all of the Jews. The king said, we cannot have this. No, of course not. Your people will not be killed. The king cared about the Jews. So, in turn, my people were saved because I was brave to approach the king and tell him what the evil plan was. Before, I did not know why I was chosen to be queen, but now I know.
God had a plan for me to save my people, and I had to be brave and speak up. You too have a purpose. Remember my story. If God asks you to do something, be brave and be strong, just like that song I heard you sing earlier this morning. Thank you, children.
Put them on the blue. There you go. just like that. That's good.
Today we went to Bronco, and whenever we, some of us stayed and did children's ministry, and some of us went into the village to just do spiritual warfare over the place and stuff. And whenever we went in there, Jarvis saw these few women, you know, and told them, hey, we'll come back and stuff. So we went on and we went into the temple, and at first I kind of felt a little heavy. I mean, it felt like my heart was in my stomach, you know, and I didn't really know what to say. I didn't know what to say to the women. There was two women that came in and started talking to us, and I didn't want to hold just shallow conversation with them, you know. I kind of felt like it needed to be a little deeper than, you know, shallow conversation, and so I didn't say much. And they told us about the temple and about the rituals that they have, you know, and just kind of asked us to not stay in the temple because we had gone in because the spirits that we had were, you know, irritating or disturbing the spirits that they had inside the temple. So they asked us to leave. And so we left, and from there we went into a museum that some of the team met. The guy, his name was Paul. I didn't meet him, and in the museum we were just looking, and I didn't understand a word he was saying, but all of a sudden I freaked out because I saw voodoo dolls, and I'm like, and I asked Anthony, is that really what that is, you know, because I didn't know, you know, I've never really seen it, you know, I know that it's real, but I didn't realize that, you know, it was reality to me now, you know. And so I kind of freaked out a little bit, and then, you know, I saw these little bowl things with like a nest in it. And I'd seen that, you know, on movies and stuff. That's kind of what they pass around and, you know, light it on fire. But when you see it, you know, for real, it's like reality, you know, and it just happens. It's like now you physically have something that you know that you need to pray for. So from there, we split up and half the team went, and we ran back into those ladies that we had seen when we first entered into the village. And immediately one of them recognized Rick as, you know, the optometrist, the eyeglasses guy, and said, where are my eyeglasses? And so while he was talking to her, I just started talking to some older women that were sitting around visiting and just asked their names and how old they were and stuff. And immediately one, her name was Gladys, she started telling me about pain in her eyes and stuff. So I grabbed Esther and I just said we were going to pray for her. And we prayed, you know, healing into her eyes and peace over her, that she may see clearly and stuff. And from there I felt like, okay, now I can do something, you know, because it was hard for me to just step out and do that, you know. And so I moved to these other two ladies and was talking to them, and they just started telling me how they didn't want to live to be 100, you know, they wanted to live 99, they wanted to be finished, because they wanted to die and be able to rest in peace and not have to come back and do it all over again. And I asked, why would you have to do it over again? And they went on to say, you know, on earth is heaven and hell, and if you have a good life then you live in heaven, and if you have a bad life then you're in hell. And so I said, so where is heaven? And they said, here, you know. And I said, you don't realize that heaven is up with Jesus, you know. And I said, you go to heaven when you die. I said, you live, this is earth, you know. And so I went on to ask them, you know, do you know, are you going to heaven or hell? You know, are you going to heaven? And they said, I don't know. That's for God to know. And I said, I know how to get to heaven. And I said, do you want me to tell you how you're going to get to heaven? And they, you know, look at me and they say, sure, you know, yes. And I said, you know that you're going to heaven when you ask Jesus in your heart. I said, have you asked Jesus into your heart? And they said, no. And I said, do you want to ask Jesus into your heart so that you know that you're going to heaven? And they said, yes. So me and Esther, we took their hands and I told them, I said, you repeat after me. You know, I'm going to pray and you pray what I pray. And so I went on to pray, you know, the sinner's prayer, and just short, you know, Lord, forgive us our sins and, you know, and stuff. And afterwards I told her, I said, now you are going to heaven and I will see you there. And I, yesterday we were talking about, like, your job unfinished. You know, I felt like it was not finished, you know, like, do they really understand that where heaven is and where hell is and who Jesus is and stuff. And so, you know, today I was just praying, and when I got back to the cabin, you know, that I may, tomorrow, maybe I could see him again and be able to explain more, you know, what it is that they've done and stuff. So it was a conquering day for me, I feel, you know, something that I was able to open up on my own, you know, and it was a good day. I liked it.
The first night that I got here, I haven't really moved in prophetic dreams and whatnot, but I've kind of been introduced to it lately. And the first night that I got here, I prayed about spiritual warfare. I don't even remember what it was about. And then the third night, I also prayed about spiritual warfare, but it centered more around Satan and his different attributes telling me, and I think I was more representing the team, but telling me that I couldn't do it, that I was powerless. But I continued and persisted in the dream and was telling him that I could. And I think I was even raising the dead, what was not living back to life again, in my dream. And I think 2 days when we were going to San Felipe that morning, or maybe the night before, when our team began to pray, I had kind of a vision, or more like a mental picture of the top of the village. You know what it looks like when a tornado is start to happen, not necessarily the sky being green, but there's a dark sky and it's something swirling around and around like this. And I really felt that the demonic, that as we prayed, because we were releasing the angelic forces and we were, you know, attacking that they were feeling it, they were hurting, and that the entire town on top of it was trying to, you know, surround it like this. And this morning, as we were going to Barranco and as our team was praying, I just felt the entire thing happening again, but on a much, much larger scale, that not only were we attacking the demonic spirits that were controlling that town in particular, but probably the entire the religion, the entire, Garifuna ideology and whatnot. But we were probably reading scripture and on the bus praying for, I'd say, close to an hour. And I would see it stirred up, but towards the end, I just slowly saw it dissolve. like the strongholds were being dissolved. And it was interesting to see that, because not only were we stirring up what was already there and making them afraid, but they were running away. And I saw that in my spirit. And then it was confirmation when Chieko stood up in the bus and said, Jesus says it is finished. Not that our work is finished in that village yet, but as far as us being afraid, you know, they are on the defensive now. You know, we were chasing after them, and I saw that in the spirit. There was a battle that has already been won even before we went into the village, and that was really cool.
Well, I was excited to go into Barranco today, because we've been praying for Barranco I've been praying for Barranco for about a year and a half, the last, actually, 9 months. Since I've tried to go in there twice, me and Melissa, the last time we were here, we were trying to go in there, but it rained a lot. It was rainy season and the roads were flooded out. And we were just really wanting to go and see the Garifuna culture. We knew their practices and their religion was very satanic and demonic. And so we just wanted to go in there and see, you know, what it's all about and see how the people are, if they're really bound down or if it's just a talk or whatever, how bound they are in this witchcraft. But we never did make it down there last year. So this year we got opportunity to bring this team down, and in our meetings on Saturdays, Barranco just keeps coming in my mind. And as we were praying, other team member like Melissa, Medina, and other team members will just, as soon as we will start praying for Barranco, she would just, Melissa is a very sensitive person to the Holy Spirit or to any kind of other demonic activity or spirits around. And so, you know, it was a battle from the start, and just a burden for Barranco, because the people are really bound down in Barranco. And so to finally be there today was for me a start of a victory, because the devil tried to stop us many times from going down into Barranco. Like about 2 days ago, 2 or 3 days ago, the person that was supposed to set up the schools for us to get in there to get permission to go into the village, the guy didn't go down there and ask permission to get into the village. And so we couldn't go into the village without permission to go into the village. And this is 2 days before we're supposed to go into the village. And normally, if you don't have a week in advance for them to get to the chief of the village and to the principal, it's kind of hard to do that, because they have to get permission. It's a letter you got to write and a bunch of other things. Anyways, it just seems to be every time we want to go in and we want to walk that land, the devil always seems to try to do something to stop us from going there, which makes the fight even more so stronger and more, we knew that we were tapping into something. We knew that we were disturbing something. We knew that we were putting fear into the heart of the devil, because he knew that if we would just ask for Barranco, that we would have it. And so he wanted to shut our mouths up. He wanted us to be quiet and go somewhere else. So he bring obstacles in the way, like the rain or you know, for us not to get permission and for us not to be welcome into the village. He tries to stop and do something all the time for us to get in there. So for us to actually be on the road this morning, traveling to Barranco, and the team is not just me and Melissa and Melissa Medina and my wife Melissa together, one, but it's the whole team as a team effort. We all knew, because we were praying for about 8 months strong. We were praying, and the whole team is excited about Barranco. Was this big talk of a big spiritual battle that we are going to win. And so for us to actually be on our way there, the intensity and the warfare was up strong today. So what was pretty cool was when we started out our journey this morning, well, we had dreams and other things that came. God gave Anthony a dream and about the children in Barranco and other people some dreams and things like that. So we knew that the Spirit But we were in tune with the Spirit, and we were yoked up with the Spirit and what the Spirit was doing, because the Spirit was talking and moving to us on how to act and how to war and how to pray and what to expect and what to tear down and things like that. So we had a really good strategy, and we were really prepared to go to Barranco today. The bus drive down there was unbelievable. The Lord just spoke forth His word in through the Scriptures. And for about, I don't know,
45 minutes.
About 45 minutes journey down there, we just one right after the other, just proclaiming Scriptures like Matthew 10, Isaiah 61. We said Joel chapter 2, we spoke Ezekiel. I mean, we were going through the Bible, Acts, and just proclaiming that the God goes before us and the battle is not ours. And God is already before us, and He's calling a great army and warfare in Scriptures. And it just built the team up. When you hear that God goes before you, and you know that He is not a man that He should lie. So whatever He say, He will do. And when you trust in God and you've been down a journey with God, you know that He never fails you. You know that He comes through for you all the time. And to get those Scriptures spoken out and to kind of remind yourself of who you are, and that we are soldiers of the army of God, that we are the army of God. To me, I felt so good to be a part of the army of God. It was just so awesome. And then we start singing songs about the army of Christ and singing about the victory and proclaiming the victory even before we even got there, that the victory was ours. And all we had to do was just go now and receive the goal from that kingdom. It's like God sent His warring angels before us, and He tore down the principalities. And all we had to do was bring in our wheelbars or bring our bus in and load up the gold from this kingdom and take back the thing that the devil has stolen from us. And so it was really awesome thing. You know, we knew basically going in there, we knew what we were saying about just going in and grabbing the gold. But reality hits, because when we actually went to the what they call the temple, where they go and they do all their rituals, and that's their church for the Garfunas and the demonic witchcraft and things like that. That's their temple, that's their church, that's their altar. So when we went into this church, to our surprise, it felt that there was no fight, you know, it's like a surprise to us. But now we understand truly that God went before us, because it was just such a, I mean, you feel a demonic presence because of our expectations, but there wasn't any battle because the battle was already won. And so I thought that was neat experience. And we'll have Steve share what he thinks. Let him share a little bit, maybe on the bus ride or whatever.
Jervis pretty much nailed it right on. For me, the main thing was that we were preparing for this, and we knew that this specific village was under demonic attack, voodoo or whatever you want to call it, and in our prayer times we just sensed it. And we had prayer one night, and I sensed something about that village. And so we knew what we were going up against, but as Jervis said, you know, I was expecting to go into this village and go to this temple where they do sacrifices for, you know, all their gods and whatever they do, and just go to battle, you know, and just expect to feel these, you know, all these, this, go to war, you know. But I truly believe, as in First Chronicles, I was telling him, when the king had to go to battle, but when he, you know, he called a fast, they prayed, and he set his, he set people in the front row to worship. So when they were going off to battle, the front row was worshiping God. And as soon as they opened their mouth to begin to worship, the enemy fell. And as Jervis said, I truly believe that before we even got there, the battle was over. Mm-hmm. Because, yeah, the temple, they do have demonic things going on in this village. But when we got there, I think that truly in the spirit realm, the demons were already defeated, and they fled.
They fled.
Like he said, there was a you could sense the demonic presence in there, but it was like we already knew. We were walking in such a peace, like victory, like, man, this is nothing. I mean, like we expected, because we truly believe that our bus ride there, we were I truly believe prophetic mm-hmm. things were coming forth, prophetic songs
yeah.
towards the end, talking about we have the victory and just mm-hmm. and the scriptures coming forth was all prophetic. And I think it was sending out arrows in the spirit. And Maria said this morning, I have an arrow on the back of my hat. And she said, what is that? I said, it's an arrow. She said, that's prophetic, because I've been thinking about arrows all morning. And I truly believe as we were praying for Barranco, and as yeah. even on the way there, we were sending out arrows, and the battle was already over, which enabled us when we got there to minister. It enabled us to walk in peace. We were able to minister to people there, lead people to salvation. And we had an encounter with a guy, Mr. Paul?
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Paul, 82-year-old man, and he moved in a peace. You know, yeah. you just sensed it on him. And we were able to read scripture with him.
Yeah.
And in a way that I don't believe that has been done yeah. to him before, mm-hmm. because he's heard the scriptures before, because there's Catholic is mixed in with this village as well. And so they've heard from the priest, but we, especially Jervis, did such a good job in explaining to him the gospel and just using illustrations like, do you understand, like when you turn on this light switch, that the light kills the darkness.
And it reveals.
It reveals the things that are in mm-hmm. in this room. Whereas if you walk into a room with no light, you're stumbling over things and you don't know what's in here. And just things like that. And you can see it in his face. It clicked. You know, mm-hmm. he's just like, wow. You know, we were explaining it to him in a different kind of a way. Not just reading scripture. We were doing that, but we were explaining everything we were reading to him. And he said his dad was made mattresses
yeah.
with weaving
some kind of
leaves together.
So when we talked to him about the predestined, we were reading in Ephesians, like I was saying, we read most of it from verses 1 all the way through to verses 23. But when we got to verses 11, number 11, in him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plans of him who works out everything for us. And I asked him, I said, do you understand what predestined means? And he really didn't understand. He says, no, I haven't heard that word. And so I said, it's something that is already planned out before it comes to reality. And but I felt in my spirit that he really, you know, saying all this, I said, Holy Spirit, show me something that he could understand. So I remember when he was talking about, when he was showing us in this museum, he was showing us different things, you know, artifacts and things like that. And he says, come in the back. He said, come in the back, let me show me mattress. Come in the back, let me show me mattress. And I'm like, okay, so he walked in the back, and he showed me this wooden bed that he had, and had a mattress, is what he was saying, that he had on there. And this mattress, like Stephen said, is made out of leaves, you know, and I touched it, and I went like that, and it's actually kind of springy, you know, and I was like, wow, this is, I can see myself maybe sleeping on this, you know. And so, anyways, so God brought that back to my remembrance when I was telling him about predestination. And because that's for myself, even so, it's confusing for me sometimes to understand predestination. But God even was ministering to me while I was talking to him about predestined. So I said to him, I says, just like your mattress, I said, your dad, as he was thinking about something to sleep on, you know, he was imagining his mind, and he was thinking about something he can make for the what'd you say, the plans or the purpose that he want. You know, he needed to sleep on something, so he was thinking, what can I make that I can have a comfortable place to sleep? So as he was thinking about the things he wants to accomplish, he thought about probably leaves, you know, and what kind of leaves, and how the leaf will come together, and how strong the leaf have to be, and all these different things like that, you know. So I was saying, while your dad was thinking about all these things, I said, he had a plan, and he had a purpose. And he's making this thing. He knew he had to make it strong because of the weight of the body, and he didn't want to make it comfortable and all these different things. So he had everything to details thought up, but he thought it in his mind before it even come to existence. Before he even actually made this mattress, he thought about what this mattress will look like, what kind of purpose this mattress will serve, how comfortable it would be. And then he went out and he started creating this mattress. And then now you have this mattress in your room. And when I said that, I said, your dad thought about it. I said, God's thoughts towards us is plenty. His plans for us, he already knows. He already knows the beginning and he knows the end. He knows everything about us because he created us. He designed us for the purpose and the things that he wants us to do and to accomplish, just like the mattress. And when I said that, it went off in his mind, and he felt so, what would you say, like he felt so, that God actually created him with a plan and a purpose. Like he thought about it, and he was like, yeah, you know. And my goodness, when that thing came out of me, it even spoke to my life. I mean, I've talked about, you know, God has a plan for us, God created us in our mother's womb, God has a plan for us. But for some reason, it was a little bit different to me also. I don't know if it ministered to you, but it ministered to me again in a new and fresh way that, man, he knows what he wants me to do. Like, you know, he formed me and he put personalities in me, characters in me. He put strengths in me that he knows I need to be this strong, just like the mattress. He knows that the leaves have to be a kind of leaf that is going to be strong enough, but still flexible enough to be comfortable, you know, for to stand the weight. Now I think about the details that he took to make that mattress. Then I thought about the details and the time and the thoughts that God had towards me as he was forming me for the plan that he wants me to do. So it was an incredible time. And then we start talking about the Holy Spirit and different things. But man, it was so... It was like... And it was awesome because the whole... The conversation, you know, kind of escalated when we were talking about the Holy Spirit. And what was cool was when we were talking about the Holy Spirit, I asked Melissa to explain... I asked Stephen to explain what the Holy Spirit is. And then we went to Melissa and she put in her, you know, the Holy Spirit spoke to her as well. And then I remember as she was reading some scriptures and she says that the Holy Spirit help us and the Holy Spirit teaches us, you know. And as we were sitting there teaching and opening up his mind, it was like so awesome because it wasn't like we were just talking about the Holy Spirit is a teacher and you're just talking. But he was actually having a session right there, learning the deep things of God. And I said, just like how you're learning right now from me. You know, you think it's just from me, but it's the Holy Spirit that is working through me. And when I leave, the Holy Spirit, just like how he brought revelation to these things that I'm showing you in Ephesians and in John and in Acts, what we're reading, you can read your Bible and the Holy Spirit can teach you the same things that, and the same way that I've been taught and be revealed, the scriptures have been revealed to me. And so it was awesome that everything, God just had it all planned out. He knew that we were going to come in contact with him. And the amazing thing was that you said, as we were talking out, what you were saying about, you know, God goes before you and everything like that. It was like, the moment I saw him walking down, because we met him in the field, he was working his cassava field, and he's the first person that we saw. And for some reason, I just got attracted to him, and I went over there, and I started talking to him. I didn't even know that he was have any involvement with where we were at that church, at the temple there, and then the museum was right next to it. And then he comes up, and he's the guy that is the one that takes you on a tour at the museum. And I told him that. I said, God has sent me here to talk to you and to minister to you, you know. And it was so awesome. It was amazing. And we had a good time with him. I hope we get to see him tomorrow And it will be a great thing. And I told him I love him. I told him I wanted to be with him every day, working out in the field. I wanted to walk beside him because he had, you know, I love to be around older people. And I told him I love to be with you and talk with you and get into word with you and work with you beside you, just like a son, you know, just like if you were my dad. And that meant so much to him because he don't have anybody. You know, he lives by himself. His wife died. And his everybody died around him. And he's just him. It's just him there at his house. And he's an older guy, he's 82 years old. And it was just amazing that we took the time, most of our time there, just talking to Paul. It's amazing. I love it.
This guy, his dad, actually was the one who founded, or he, I guess, he is the first person to start that village. I guess he was the first migrant from wherever in the late 18, I guess early, I don't know, because this guy was really old. He was 82 years old anyway. So anyway, basically he had authority over this village. I don't know if he was like the head person over the village or if, you know, I don't know how it works with the village. But when we were telling him that and Jervis was saying to him, you know, you realize that when you speak, people are going to listen. You have authority. Your father is the one who founded this village. You're 82 years old. You're a wise man. And it was just like we were speaking things into him, and I saw in his face, you know, that he was receiving it. Mm-hmm. And from when we first met him until when we left his house, like Jervis said when he was telling him, you know, I wish I could just be here like, you know, like your son, that you could, you know, that I could walk by your side. And he just... He started standing taller when he was walking, and he kind of had a smile on his face, you know, and it just, you could see that it meant so much to him. And that's what's awesome about these three weeks that we're here, is that we're not just going and we're not just, you know, preaching a bunch of scripture to people, and we're not just going out there and preaching the same gospel that hundreds of other groups have come out. You know, I truly believe every single place that we've gone, you can see the impact in their face, because we're not just about going and getting numbers and seeing how many people that we can bring to salvation. We really care, and I think, you know, from the first day that you were ministering to somebody in one of the huts, and you just really were good using illustrations, and I think that's so good here when you can say something they can relate to. Mm-hmm. You know, when they can relate to the gospel through something like water, or through something like a light, when you can do that, I think then you can get them, and you can tell on their face right when they get it.
Yeah.
And so that was what was so awesome to me, is just seeing, we were walking in victory today, just as we were singing on the bus, you know, on the way there. It was just like all victory today.
Yeah. So one of the cool thing about darkness that I told him, and then you already mentioned a little bit about stumbling around, you know, but light not only reveals to you, reveals the hidden things, you know, because we felt in the village that when we walked into this temple, you know, we felt the demonic presence, like we said, but it was like, but a presence was still there, but you know, they fled, you know, they were so scared, and they know that their army and their power was too small, so they just kind of went away, and so when we got there, we're like, oh, what's going on, you know, but, so when I said that to him about the light switch and everything, about things in the darkness will have to be called to light and not be hidden, it's like right there, the Spirit of God told me that lady that he put in my mind that is over this village, that she didn't show her face yet, and that she was off somewhere in the village hidden because she's scared, because she don't have any power. She lost her powers. But it's like the demons where it says, Lord, have you come to torment us, you know? And it's like she didn't want to get tormented. She didn't want to get, you know, hit over the head, you know, and cast out. And when I said about darkness hidden, I remember that. And then I just start praying in my spirit that she will not be hidden, you know, she will not be hidden, that she will be revealed, you know. And then the thing with the light, the darkness, you know, with the light coming on and darkness leave. But then what the cool thing was that I told him that the light, when it switched on in this room, because they had all the artifacts in there, and there's a museum, and they cherish their culture. So when you put the light on, I said, look at this awesome artifacts, all these old ancient things and all that stuff. I said, if the light wasn't on, you wouldn't be able to see the treasures that you have in here, you know? I said, when the Holy Spirit comes in you, He reveals what's inside of you. You know, He reveals all the treasures inside of you. He reveals all the beauty about you. He reveals all the gifts about you. But if you don't have the Holy Spirit in you, these gifts and your anointing and all those things will stay hidden and closed up inside of you. But once you receive the Holy Spirit of God, you're...
Squeezing a lime into my water. You know, this is actually really good if you have diarrhea. So I would suggest that to anyone who has diarrhea. You know, the really runny kind?
Rachel, you have not diarrhea?
Diarrhea. Diarrhea. Yes. It's not bad. Diarrhea.
The first and you feel something burst, diarrhea.
What?
Diarrhea.
When you're sliding into second, and
when you're riding on the bus and you feel it start to bust, diarrhea.
It's Kobe Bryant. What's up, Kobe?
I just come back. I got a choco, but it lean up what I bring.
I got some glass here, but I must drop it.
There are two of that?
Glass. The finishing part is the glass. I broke shash window, glass, and scrape it against
something. You broke a people window for this?
No, man, I've passed with the boat, and I make use of everything, correct?
Yeah.
Glass. This is how I want to put my face, right? I have to complete it. See? So I have to bring you a little bit more.
Sure. Show the man where I come out.
You know?
I got too close.
I'm sure, trying to put this lion here, and this lion represents the Lion of Judah, which is Jesus.
Woo! Come on!
That's what I'm saying. You know, right here, I'm going to put this Tower of David, you know? And I'm supposed to go by the
children. No, you're a preacher.
To have a trade. You know, I do my artwork, but I'm
the preacher,
I'm
no,
on
yeah,
a
mama.
Cash flow timing right now.
You know?
But I was looking for my... Oh, there it is. I tell you, I look. See, there. This is one of my tools. Piece of glass that people throw away. I find it in the garbage. I scrape with it. Right, I scrape with it.
Uncle Village on the Caribbean Sea in Belize, Central America. We're enjoying a wonderful day with one of our four indigenous people groups, the Garugano people. Look at all of them, how much joy they have in their hearts. But the only sad thing is simply that most of them are caught up in an ancient ancestral worship that keeps them from truly understanding the power of Christ. And it's our desire to set them free from that bondage. And we're doing it through love and through relationship, because with these young men and these young women, you can only do it through relationship. By the power of God, He could set them free. Right now we're doing the balloon race. Oh, one went down. Trying their best not to pop a water balloon.
Boys are great. The concrete wasn't dilapidated or anything. Everything besides the concrete was.
doors, windows, and all that.
Hi, I missed
Bless their house. Bless their life, Lord, with health and strength. No sickness come near their bodies. Lord, we ask that the Holy Spirit of God may be with them in everything they do, in everything their hand touches. Let it be blessed of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for this meal. Help to be nourishment to our bodies, God. That no sickness would come near our body, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
So what is it like here in Barranco? I mean, what is your everyday living here in Barranco? What do you hear in the morning time when you wake up? What is the day like?
Well, the first thing you usually hear is the birds.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you heard a little howlers. You know, basically, we mostly live by farming and fishing.
Farming and fishing. About how many fishermen you have going out every day?
We have like.
Boy, you just broke the money.
Say like 5 fishermen for the day.
Yeah.
It's a small community, and we have like 5 fishermen.
No, those fishermen, do they do for their personal business or is just for the community? And then everybody go to the market. Who gets the majority of the money? Is it for basically money for the government that runs? For the village or just personal fisherman?
Just personal fisherman.
Personal fisherman. Yeah. Then when he bring back a fish, he carry it to the market.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. That's what else kind of industry that you do here?
Well, we don't have no other industry as such now.
Mm-hmm.
It's mostly that farming and fishing that we really fun like this.
And what is your crime like here?
Well, crimes, we don't have any crimes.
You don't have any crimes?
No, we don't have any crimes.
No burglary?
No, we don't have no burglary. No rape, no murders, nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Now this is probably one of the only places in the world that I know so far that their crime rate is basically nothing. How would you say, how is that even possible? How does it come about? Why is it like that?
Well, I think, you know, We people are known as being some of the humblest people, you know, and we know to get around without have to go through that violence and things like that. No?
Mm-hmm.
We work around the violence and work with positiveness.
Mm-hmm. And how, when you say work around, what do you guys do to work around it?
Well, you know, the way how we control it, like, the elders, they're responsible for whatever kid doing wrong.
Mm-hmm.
They can stop that kid and just put him, hey, you're doing wrong, and things like that. No, that's the way we carry
the
out.
The elders, ourselves. Which means the parents?
The parents, it don't have to be, you know, it doesn't have to be my kid. It can be your kid. I can tell him, hey, you're doing wrong, and we don't have to go through
so
any problems.
So you have the permission to talk to somebody else's kids?
Yep.
To keep everybody
united.
In check?
Yep.
As you would say.
Yeah, man.
Yes. So basically everybody's is looking out for the healthiness of the community by helping each other out with the raising up of their children, the raising up of basically a community.
Yeah.
So everybody helps with raising up of a community. So if everybody talks to everybody's kids and keep them humble, then the community.
Yeah, that's the way that was passed on to us from our forefathers too, no?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's good. What is it, what do you mean the forefathers, who is that?
Well, say our ancestors, they grow us up into that, so we try to
keep that
going on into the future.
Into
no?
the future. So your future depends on the younger ones, the next generation, the ones that can carry it on.
Yeah.
So you take pride and you take you put energy into raising up the children right, because they
are
if you don't give it to them, it won't go on again. And that's exactly the reason why we're here. Mm-hmm. The reason why we're here is we love children. And we love children of the world. Every children. We just love being around children.
Yep.
Because we believe if we can love on children, we want to go to places which we can probably learn a lot from you here, because you guys here love your children. But we find places and we go into places that children don't get love. You know? And so we try to show them love so they can have love and so they can start loving others. Like take it to the next generation behind them.
Yeah.
You know? But which is good for us, that we know that we came into a place that already has that, that people already believe in the children, and that they know that if you want a community strong, if you want a healthy community, if you want crime to not be, you need to raise your children right.
Yep.
You know? So that's what our ministry is we believe in the next generation. We believe that if you reach the children, you will reach another, you will reach the next generation.
For real, man, because the children are the future, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Children are the future. Yeah. Do you have any children?
I have one.
You have one? How old is her?
One year.
One year old.
CFNI versus Belize World Cup team. Take one.
I don't think it matters.
So what's your anticipation for this game? How do you think the outcome is going to be?
Well, we are playing BBS, the Barrancan Barefoot Soccer Team, and we're basically just going to get it handed to us. I was pretty nervous already, and then I look over and they're pulling jerseys out. So obviously they know what they're doing, and we're gonna die. Like, we are going to die. Like, poor Christian can't even beat little five-year-old. I don't know what's gonna happen now.
So what do you see the spread being?
As much as they can score against nothing. So thinking maybe 30 or 40, nothing. We might get a lucky goal in there. So let's say 40-1.
Okay, I'm
nicknaming them BBS, Barrancan Barefoot Soccer Team.
Yeah, I think they're gonna take me out because I broke the goal.
Yeah.
They're gonna take me out and just out back.
Hey, is he gonna play?
Yeah, I'm playing.
I got him.
All right, Belizean football is a tight game. Usually, it's always very competitive, and both teams always want to win. But as you know, both teams can't win. There's always a winner, so it's just much of a physical action, and it's showing off your skill, basically, how good you are at soccer and things like that.
Do you learn to play soccer before you can walk?
Well, to you guys, I can say so, yes, because then, like, I think at the age of 3 or 4, these guys are already kicking ball, they're already playing around and just learning the ability to touch the ball.
Do they sleep with their soccer balls?
Probably on as a pillow, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen Saving Private Ryan? This is a reenactment.
You're doing good, bro. Keep it up. You can move. If it's anywhere around you here, Brandon, go after the ball.
Come on, King!
Kick it in, kick it in. You got help, up. Andrew!
Come on, Andrew.
Help out, just
yeah, right there.
Connor, watch the middle. Good catch. Go on.
Good job, man.
Nice, nice.
Good job, Adrian.
Nice grab.